So this is day four of the G Fuel Bootcamp. You know, the boys are finally having a full day of scrims. Day one was a little messy for them. Came in late. Boys kind of filtered in as the day went on and had the opportunity to play there. Day two, we got a little bit more of a full day with some VOD reviews in. I think the boys played close to 12 to 14 hours. And yesterday was a busy day for them as well. Today, the plan is basically just scrims all day long. You know, they haven't had a full day with everybody here. It's the first opportunity we've had to have all four duos playing together. You know, everybody's here. Everybody has the opportunity to learn from each other. So the goal over the next, let's say, 10 hours or so is to get, you know, our duo scrims in, trio scrims up, and then we'll VOD review as a team. I think the boys are learning from Blue T a little bit, you know, being the eldest. I think he's got 6 or 7 years on pretty much everybody else here, and they look up to him. He's a smart player, and the guys are learning from him. And at the same time, a guy like Blue's got the opportunity to learn a little bit from the mechanical gods.
So before signing to E11, PAX West was coming up shortly. It was like a week away, and some dude on Twitch was just hassling me, just kept asking me, do you want to join an org? Do you want to join an org? And, you know, a week before PAX West, I thought about it. I was like, you know what? Just shoot me an email. I'll check it out. And looking at the email, it was pretty genuine. It looked trustworthy. PAX West, literally like 3 days after, representing the org. When I first saw Ollie, he gave me the biggest hug and had the biggest smile on his face. When I walked out my door, I realized I was in New York, and it just felt like everything was, I was in the moment, I was in the zone. It just put me in the zone, and I feel so comfortable here. I'm like, I've been breathing this air for like days, and everyone's saying the city smells. I don't know, it feels great being here.
As it started going on further, I got more and more nervous as it came closer. And then as we were trying to get some sleep, I wanted some good like 8, 9 hours, 10 hours sleep so I could be prepared for the event. As it went on around 4 a.m, we had someone banging on our door, double fisted, just repeatedly for, I don't know, like a good like 20 seconds straight or something. He just looks startled when we open the door and it's not the right person and goes away. On to Saturday, waking up to the day of the event, I don't know, I kind of let it get to me a little bit, because normally I try not to think about the money or like the scale of the event. I just go there to do what I have to do, you know? I just had like a really sore stomach. I was kind of weird. So I tried to have some decent breakfast, some food that would like keep me energy through the day. I didn't really practice the night before the tournament. I maybe played 3 hours. 3 hours we were given. A lot of people were grinding the whole day. It's not really going to help. You're either just going to like ingrain bad habits in yourself or other things. I think it's the months of like preparation before, with all the muscle memory, everything, it's like the months before of training. It's not the, we go out to the stage, we're like taken out, given the preview, got to warm up. I felt good about it because I knew Derek's turned up for the day, and I knew he was feeling good and feeling excited about it. Sit down, I think from that point on, just from the practice, we just focused on warming up. But I think me and Derek, like you said, we were kind of, we were lighthearted about it. We were making jokes in the tunnel about doing the Homer grind and stuff like that if we win. So it's our turn to get presented. I think this is when Derox would either he would either get nervous or he would be completely fine. And luckily, he was fine. And you could see the camera came, didn't really get fazed by it, people looking. But I think we both just felt like we were at home.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the Fortnite World Cup Finals live from my hometown, baby. New York City, where you at? Where you at? That's what I like to hear. That's what I like to hear. This is it, people. The moment that we've been waiting for. 10 weeks of competition leads to this. I'm your host, Golden Boy, and I couldn't be more pumped to be here because we're about to see the greatest Fortnite players in the world.
You came out of nowhere with people like, who are you guys qualifying in the first run? Going to look to make a run at it here today.
Kluja and Thomas HT.
Low Stompy Chicken, a duo that I want to have my eyes on quite a bit. We see a quick little edit fight here through the wall, and they pick off Zex Rose.
So at this point, we finished game six. We were happy. We didn't know where we stood. We kind of had a good understanding. We'd done well, and we saw, we were like, holy shit, we're eighth. Like, this is insane. And I remember seeing Tarek and Drew celebrating, kind of taking pictures, which was nice, comforting. And then we saw our names on the board, and that was the best feeling. Honestly, the best feeling I've ever had. Even though we did really well, we won a lot of money, I was quite upset, honestly, to be too quite brutal with you. I was back in my hotel. I just wanted to be alone. Really annoyed with myself, because I knew... We were 15 points from first.
Zach and I started this organization with the intention that we were going to treat players the right way and treat our staff the right way, and really change the industry and change the standard with how players and everyone's treated. You know, at the end of the day, we work with minors, kids who are traveling far away from their homes, and what we do as an organization always comes back to how we're treating our staff and our players and everyone around us. And that's what makes us so passionate. And that's why this weekend has been so draining, which you can see on my face right now, because you really, really ride the roller coaster with them. And it's not just a player that's under contract. It's really a family that we've built. And to see the highs and lows that they see, it makes it even harder when they don't perform the way that they think they're going to perform. And that at its core is the hardest to take in. We're on the come up. And to have the favorites going into the World Cup, a $30 million prize pool, regardless of the outcome, that's a serious accomplishment. To have the fourth most represented players in the whole competition, that's a serious accomplishment. Come next year, we hope to be number one, and we'll continue to grow. Everything we do, whether it's social, whether it's sponsorships, whether it's players, and even working with our staff, we want to improve every single day. So if it means placing higher next year, that's our goal, and that's our challenge, and that's what we need to work on in order to be... to continue to be relevant and one of the most talked about organizations in Fortnite.